I know we've had a great day. We've had three great lectures. We're looking forward to one more wonderful talk tonight and then the concert after that. It's my pleasure this evening to introduce to you Dr. Laura Triplett, Associate Professor of Geology, to introduce our next speaker.
Hello. What a day of amazing photos and stories about the ocean that makes me want to go to the ocean right now. And here we are. So take a breath. With each breath, you bring air into your body, a mixture of gases. For one, we have oxygen emitted by plants, grass outside, or the rainforests in Indonesia. But also, as Dr. Gallo pointed out this morning, the multitudes of algae and photosynthesizing bacteria that live in the ocean. Take another breath. Carbon dioxide emitted by a variety of sources, including many human activities. But also at least a couple of those molecules you breathed in may have come from an undersea volcano along the mid-ocean ridge. And another breath. Water vapor. The sun shines on that vast ocean and water evaporates up and blows across the planet and comes here. It gives us our rain and our snow. If it weren't for the oceans, this would be a desert. All land would be a desert. We are bound to the ocean, and the ocean is bound to us. When we do things here, when we are careless with our industries, when we are careless with how we burn coal, or how we incinerate our garbage or mine certain things, things like mercury go up into the air, and they blow across the planet, and they land on the ocean, and the ocean breathes it in, and organisms absorb it and consume it. And mercury is a poison. Our next guest, Dr. William Fitzgerald, has spent his career studying how mercury moves from one part of our world to another. He has been a driving force in convincing us that humans have significantly increased the amount of mercury cycling through our environment today. It's a recent phenomenon. Dr. Fitzgerald has vastly improved our ability to measure mercury. Because if you can't accurately measure it in water or air or fish, you're never going to understand what's going on. And he spent a lot of time helping us understand how mercury can change from one fairly non-toxic form, elemental mercury, to another very toxic form, methyl mercury. And that happens in certain places like wetlands and lakes and oceans, ocean sediments. If we don't understand the chemistry of how that change happens, we can't protect ourselves and protect our ocean ecosystems. Dr. Fitzgerald is a distinguished professor emeritus at the University of Connecticut. He has been a faculty member there since 1970 studying mercury. He has received almost continuous funding for his research from the National Science Foundation. That's one indication of the value that our society places on his work. He, in 2003, received the Geochemical Society's Patterson Award for environmental chemistry research, and last year received the first Catherine R. Mahaffey Lifetime Achievement Award in mercury research. So please help me welcome Dr. Fitzgerald.
Oh, great. Good evening, and thank you very much, Laura. That was an extraordinary introduction. I hope I can live up to it. In fact, she missed very little, frankly.
I've been studying Mercury for roughly 40 years. It began while I was a graduate student, and I want you to just emphasize how sometimes you're affected by a lecture. And Ed Goldberg, who was a chemical oceanographer at the Scripps Institution of Oceanography, talked about the Minamata Bay poisoning, which was methylmercury poisoning. And it moved me to really change my entire focus. I saw this as an opportunity to make a societal commitment as well as to do science. And as a one consequence of that is that we see that the periodic table somewhat differently than most chemists. It's mercury and its supporting cast. And the next slide is a nice picture of a ship in a decent sea. And I say the mercury world has discovered the oceans. For years, the oceans were ignored. Most of the studies that were carried out on mercury were in terrestrial systems. As you'll see as I go through this, the oceans are recognized. There are numbers of groups now studying mercury. So over the last decade or so, the oceans have been a very important focus. And I'm pleased, frankly. An environmental pursuit of mercury, why are we doing this? Now, Laura went through much of this, and I'll go through quickly. Mercury, many of its compounds are volatile. They're readily mobilized and dispersed in the environment. And elemental mercury is the primary form that we have in the air. And there's a small amount in the air here. But emissions of mercury in the northern hemisphere or even in this building that makes it outside could perhaps end up depositing in the southern hemisphere. There's a significant anthropogenic component. Coal combustion is a major portion of that. Mercury has a complex aquatic cycle. And we'll be discussing aspects of this. It bioaccumulates, but the form bioaccumulating is methylmercury, and it is very toxic. Forms of mercury then, just to reiterate, elemental mercury you're familiar with, from thermometers, thermostats, and all sorts of other types of instruments. Mercuric ions are mercury salts, in some batteries. There are organic mercury complexes that are used in pharmaceuticals. And then there's methylmercury, which is a singly charged ion, and that's the form that you find accumulating in fish. This is a list of a lot of features of mercury, and I won't go through this in detail, but I'll highlight. The sources of mercury are primarily from the mining of cinnabar, mercuric sulfide. It's a beautiful mineral. Purified, it forms pigments, rouge. It's been used back to Egyptian times. And all you have to do is heat it in air. You drive off the sulfur dioxide, and you're left with mercury. And the Almaden mine in Spain has been active since Roman times. The anthropogenic sources, I've already mentioned coal, there's biomass combustion. And if you're over here under uses, gold and silver extraction. Mercury's been used to amalgamate gold for several hundred years. And now small-scale gold mining, in part because of the increase in the price of gold, has taken on a very significant, it's influencing the anthropogenic component rather significantly now. The natural sources, probably the only pure natural source is volcanoes. There have been mass poisonings in Minamata Bay, and I'm going to talk about that in a moment, Niigata and in Iraq. And there are human health advisories, so I think we're all familiar with that. Minnesota happens to be particularly proactive. Fish consumption advisory directorate, especially towards children and women of childbearing age. There are guidelines from the US EPA and the FDA, as well as the World Health Organizations. And a few words about Minamata Bay. As I indicated, this this tragedy, and it's a major tragedy. It was the largest industrial accident before Bhopal took place in the about 20 years ago in India. So Minamata then was in the island of Kyushu. community depended on the fishing and seafood for its livelihood. The Chisso Chemical Company started an acetaldehyde plant there in the late 1920s. And they were making acetaldehyde from acetylene. And is acetylene going to acetaldehyde? And mercuric sulfate was added as a catalyst. And a byproduct, unintended, but this is not unusual in many pollution situations, was methylmercury. And it entered Minamata Bay from the drainage waters and eventually concentrated substantially, so that's the first evidence of the, both deaths and poisonings occurred in the 1950s. So if you look at Minamata Bay, it was effectively a methylmercury time bomb. It took roughly 25 years or so before the evidence of the poisoning, and acute poisoning, occurred. The Minamata Disease Memorial is symbolized by these silvery spheres moving towards a water wall, which is would be Minamata Bay. But Minamata Bay is actually in the background. So it really wasn't these silvery spheres or mercury in the elemental form. It was methylmercury that was entering. And I'm not going to show any type of pictures from that, but I recommend a book that was published in 1975 by the famous photojournalist Eugene Smith with his wife Eileen. And it's the story of the poisoning and the people who not only had the burden of the poisoning as well, and an enormous courage in trying to finally get some settlements from and recognition from the Japanese government. There were at least 1,300 deaths and more than 10,000 poisonings. In Minamata Bay now, those contaminated sediments have been removed. They've been placed in landfills, capped, and this is a ball field. And so the acute portion of that now is no longer exists. But in nature, methylmercury does form naturally. And we'll illustrate that over the next few slides. Here, again, as I mentioned, elemental mercury is the primary form in the atmosphere, and as well as divalent mercury is the oxidized species. Elemental mercury is oxidized in the presence of sunlight to ionic mercury, that mercury salt that we highlighted in the beginning, and that settles into both land and to aquatic systems. And forms of mercury, and I hope this doesn't get too complicated. We have elemental mercury, methylmercury, and we abbreviate methylmercury as MMHG, and we also have dimethylmercury, and mercury associated with organic and inorganic substances would be mercury associated with ligands, and there we can have transformations among these species, abiotically and biotically. This is a mercury cycle. This applies to lakes in Minnesota as it does to a coastal zone. And I'll just walk us through this, and I think I suspect it will be clear. I hope it's going to be clear. If it isn't, raise your hand. Oh. That's what we do in class. So elemental mercury then oxidized to mercury 2, and we consider that reactant enters the aquatic phase. It can be associated with a variety of dissolved substances and even particles, and it can be converted in the water column to monomethylmercury or dimethylmercury, and these can convert into one another. You can even get some reduction in elemental mercury and elemental mercury returning to the atmosphere. In one sense, that's a good thing because it reduces the amount of mercury that's in the system. The methylmercury accumulates in biota, and we'll see that in some detail in a moment. But most of the methylation takes place in the sediments, in the coastal zone, and again, most lakes. And it's driven by microbes. And the microbes are sulfate-reducing bacteria and iron-reducing bacteria, but it's particularly sulfate-reducing bacteria. And that's the one evidence of their activity is at low tide, for example, in Long Island Sound, where our labs are operating. Exists the smell of rotten eggs, and the controls then on the methylation that takes place in sediments There, it has to do with the amount of loadings of mercury. You increase the loadings, you can increase the production of methylmercury. Certain organic matter can, in the right types of organic matter, can increase methylation, but it also can sequester the reactive mercury and reduce methylation. Sulfur in small amounts enhances methylation, and larger amounts it precipitates the mercury and basically sequesters it and lowers methylation. And again, it's driven by bacterial activities, sulfate-reducing bacteria, iron-reducing bacteria. And the healthier the sediments, the more conducive they are to the production of methylmercury. Here we see this in a sort of a cartoon fashion. If we look down in the sediments here, and I hope you can see this, mercury being converted to methylmercury, catalyzed by sulfate-reducing bacteria and iron-reducing bacteria. It can enter then the lower parts of the food chain, plankton, eaten by zooplankton, by small fish, and then eventually end up in larger fish, predators. And again, just to reemphasize, to make sure everything is clear, methylmercury is the form that bioaccumulates and diamagnifies. And here we have phytoplankton, and this is what we call a bio concentration factor. That means there's about, and phytoplankton is about 10,000 times as much mercury, methylmercury as there is in water. And zooplankton is more like 100,000. And planktivorous fish, it's about 1 million. And piscivorous fish, it's between 1 million and 10 million. And nearly all of the mercury in fish is methylmercury. And this is an example of this. And again, I'm going to show a number of graphs, but you don't have to. This is increasing methylmercury in this direction and increasing total mercury in this direction. And, and we have a very nice linear relationship. And this is for data that we, that Chad, in fact, Chad Hammerstein obtained for lobster, alewife that feeds on plankton, flounder, bluefish, and tautog for Long Island Sound. And this applies generally. So again, to summarize, methylmercury then is the bioaccumulating and biomagnifying. About 80% of the global fish consumption is harvested from the sea. In the United States, it's greater than 60%. Methylmercury is a neurotoxin, an endocrine disruptor, and something between 5 and 10%, something in the range of 5 to 10% of the women in the United States of childbearing age have blood methylmercury high enough to harm the development fetus. And a result of that is that there are large numbers of fish consumption advisory. Every state in the U.S. has a fish consumption advisory of some type. And what I want to focus is the state advisories right along here, if you notice. These are coastal advisories. Roughly a decade ago, you wouldn't have found that there. And this is for Alaska, and this is for Hawaii. And now, bear with me, please. I just hope this all works. I'm going to do a couple of things that nobody advised me not to do it. I just want to make sure this is work. So how much methylmercury needs to accumulate to sustain all the methylmercury we have in fish in the oceans? It's the question. And we have a sense of how much productivity there is with respect to fish production. And the major fish production is in upwelling regions. And some of those are in coastal zones as well, and in the coastal zone. The open ocean, for the most part, does not produce a large amount of fish in terms of carbon. And the mercury input, then, and this is where I'm going to use the term megamoles. Now, mega doesn't bother you because megabytes and so on, but a mole is 200 grams of mercury. But the mole units really allows us to use simple units without exponents. And the amount we need to sustain the accumulation of methylmercury is about 0.2 megamoles. And the total amount of mercury going into the oceans is about 20 megamoles. So that means just 1 to 2% of the total mercury that's entering the oceans each year needs. If that's converted then in a net way to methylmercury, that can account for all the methylmercury that's accumulating yearly in the biota. And so the potential sources of methylmercury then for ocean fish, rivers, atmospheric deposition, production in sediments on a continental margin, intermediate water production, particularly in the oxygen minimum zone, and deep sea sediments. Now, we're going to focus on these two, on the continental margin. I've just showed you illustrations of with lakes and coastal waters of how methylmercury can produce in the sediments, and also we'll move to more to the open ocean and look at production there as well. And then to summarize them with respect to the coastal zone, consumption of fish is the principal route of human exposure to methylmercury. Greater than 60% of the fish consumed by Americans is from marine systems, and most marine fish production is in the coastal zone. And there's limited knowledge about the sources, the production, the biogeochemistry, the accumulation of methylmercury in the oceans, and especially in biologically productive coastal marine systems. Now, this has an East Coast focus, but yeah, I have Long Island Sound, New York, New Jersey Harbor, New York Bight, that this would apply to continental shelves in general. So there's limited knowledge worldwide with respect to what's happening in the coastal zone regarding the cycling and accumulation of mercury. Again, and I hope this works, this is a scaling exercise, the type of thing that we do in class. And let's just assume that there are those other sources don't exist and that all of the methylmercury is coming from the coastal zone. So how much mercury how much methylmercury has to be produced in order to account for the amount in the ocean fish? So there's our point two again, right here. This is just simply dividing by the area of the coastal zone, and you end up with a value of 20, and this is picomoles per meter squared per day. And again, I don't think we should worry about the units, just think 20. So 20 is a number that we're interested in comparing results against. If it's near 20, then it's important. If it's much less than 20, it's not important. And we're going to focus on right this area here, close to home. There's Connecticut, Long Island, New York, and Long Island Sound. We'll look at three stations on the shelf. And then later, I'm going to present data for dated sediments from the Pettaquamscut estuary. And these are sediment water methylmercury fluxes, lots of numbers, easy to emphasize. All of them, with the exception of two, one is the continental shelf, happened to be nine, are above that 20. San Francisco Bay, it's 30. New York, New Jersey Harbor, depending how you made the measurements, between 40 and 60. Long Island Sound, 47. Boston Harbor is up to 190. Lavaca Bay, and these are all contaminated systems, 210. That's 10 times the 20 picomoles. And the Gulf of Trieste, it's huge. And the reason it's huge is that the mercury's been draining into the Gulf of Trieste for at least 400 years from the Idria mine, which is now closed. So we can see the contaminated systems yield mercury levels, methylmercury fluxes that are quite significant. And then this is a study by Yanni Benoit, which I really always liked because it shows the effect of healthy sediments, if you will. Burrow density is sort of analogous to the infaunal activity in the sediments. And the fluxes of methylmercury that are generated by this mixing approached 200 picomoles per meter squared per day, or 10 times the figure that we estimated. So now looking at Long Island Sound, a budget, and this is in moles per year. Again, just focus on the numbers. So we have sources are in blue. There's salt marshes, not very large. Wastewater treatment facilities are not very large. Atmospheric deposition, a little higher. The major external sources to Long Island Sound is the East River, which connects Long Island Sound with New York, New Jersey Harbor, and the Connecticut Rivers. And this all adds up to about 35% of the input. But if you look at the benthic flux here in blue, that's 55. And that is roughly equivalent to the total amount of methylmercury accumulating in the biota. Readily can account for that's accumulating. The other sinks, you lose some to photodemethylation. There's a small amount of it that deposits, and you lose a little bit by tidal exchange. But the benthic flux is extraordinarily significant. And to summarize that, so about 65% of the methylmercury is produced internally. And it's comparable to the amount of methylmercury accumulating in fish and other biota in the sound. All sources of methylmercury, whether internal or external, have a significant anthropogenic component. And how do we know that? Well, anthropogenic contributions are derived from observations and from models. The model suggests that the sources of mercury about two-thirds are sources of mercury to the atmosphere, about two-thirds comes from anthropogenic sources, and about two-thirds of that is from coal. But we'd like to carry out an experimental research that will allow us to assess exactly what that anthropogenic contribution is. And I didn't make this clear, but there's a global component to deposition, and there's a global anthropogenic component to deposition, as well as a local regional component. And the first thing I'll show you with respect to atmospheric deposition is the global. And this is what will be happening. This is the amount of mercury that will be depositing in the open ocean, as well as other remote areas. So the global increase in mercury deposition since the Industrial Revolution is 3 plus or minus 1. So there's been a 200% increase globally as a consequence of anthropogenic activities. And this is based on multi-core sediment archives from remote lakes that have been dated. There are 182 cores, and there have been 90 lakes, most in the northern hemisphere, but there are two samples from the southern hemisphere, New Zealand and Uganda. And these are the data here. And you see this is 3 plus or minus 1, and you get some sense of the variation. So the global anthropogenic emissions have altered mercury fluxes to the same degree worldwide. That's the global cycle. So no matter where we are examining the effect of anthropogenic activities, we'll know that the background anthropogenic signal would be at least 200% of what occurred prior to the Industrial Revolution. So what's happening with respect to Long Island Sound? And here we have this Petaquam estuary right nearby, and it's about 5 miles in length, and it has its bottom waters have not turned over for 1,700 years. It's a very, very stable environment. It's sulfide-rich, mercury is sequestered, and it has VOB, so we can tell seasonal accumulations. And it's very flocculent, and it has to be sampled by freeze coring. And this rectangular wedge has in it dry ice and methylol. It's carefully put into the sediment. The sediment is frozen, attached to that core. It's brought from the water, and then kept frozen, and it's then sliced frozen into 0.5 centimeter sections. And those can be dated by the VOBs, the differences in seasonal variation, and dated using a natural lead isotope. And this is what we see in the sediment core profile. And this is just against depth versus concentration. But we see here at about 15 centimeters or so, we start to see a substantial increase, and over a depth of almost 10 centimeters, you have the highest amounts, and it decreases down towards 30 centimeters or so. And so that tells you that there's been an increase, but we need the dates, and we have those here. This is 2000, 1800, this is the concentration, and again, that enhancement occurs starting about 1930, and levels off about 1950 or so, up to about 1970. And then declines. But if we look at the flux ratio for the Petaquamskit, and this would apply to Long Island Sound, the flux ratio at the surface then, and this is at about 2000, year 2000, is 4 plus or minus 0.6. So you can see that's the additional contribution then from local regional sources over the background global signal of which would be 3. And it's interesting, this went up to as high as 12 compared to pre-industrial deposition. So there was an enormous amount of mercury being added at this time from human activities. We think this represents, and this is more anecdotal because it's speculation, that this is due to the coal signal, burning of coal, the use of coal, transition over to oil, led to the decrease plus emission controls. And so the conclusion with respect to that assessment on mercury deposition for remote areas is that it's remarkably uniform and it's about 2/3 anthropogenic. There are localized enhancements. Dan Engstrom has done this in the Minneapolis region, and it looks very much like the Pettaquamscut estuary, which is interesting. So in Long Island Sound is about 3/4 anthropogenic. But there are clear decreases in mercury deposition over the last two to three decades near emission sources, and that's really good news, considering that I was at least as much as 12 times pre-industrial previously. So the question then is, do increases in human-related sources of mercury lead to enhanced production of methylmercury in marine and fresh waters? So you add more mercury anthropogenically, do we end up with more methylmercury being produced? And so this moves us on then to the tundra, and which I love, frankly. This is above the Arctic Circle. That's a mosquito, I think, here that was captured. That was captured on a photograph. You know, I've been thinking, how can a chemist compete with what we've seen today? We analyze water, I show it to you, it's clear. We analyze air, I show it to you, it's clear. But we have mosquitoes. And I'll show you those in a moment. And so we work above the Arctic Circle on the north slope, a couple of 150 miles from the Arctic Ocean. And we work out of the Tulik Field Station, Research Station, and that's funded by the National Science Foundation, and it provides us with an excellent base of operation. And that's the Brooks Range in the background. And there we have it. Now, I, from Minnesota, are you surprised by this? That's Dan Engstrom and his, he loved that fleece jacket. It came from the Science Museum in Minneapolis. And so that's an elite. And I've been told that you can probably, on a good day, get around 200 mosquitoes squatting you, slapping your thigh. So that's my biological slide. So the question is methylmercury related to mercury loadings, the reactive loadings. And this is just a beautiful little study that Chad Hammerschmidt started. And he mentioned that curiosity has been used a number of times today. And you have all those mosquitoes. Chad, during one of our field trips, was thinking, well, just do the mosquitoes have any methylmercury in them? And so he measured it, and it had methylmercury, and it's relatively easy to measure. Now we're thinking of them as, and I want to quickly buy that, as potential bioindicators. And from that start, and here we are in Alaska, and I'll mention the bars to you in a moment, he engaged mosquito people in the United States. And believe me, they're really happy to talk to you. You know, there are not that many people, you know. Wow! Pete, there's somebody here who wants us to work with them on mosquitoes. So we had samples from California and sort of coastal area, the Midwest, and Bay County, Florida. And Chad did all this. And the colors represent the amount of mercury that's depositing. And there are rain collectors in these places collecting it. And so you can see, and the beauty of this is that Alaska is something between 0 and 3 micrograms per meter square per day. And again, it's just think of 0 to 3. And Bay County, it's 15, so there's a factor of 10. So there's this broad range of wet deposition, and that just worked out perfectly. And the data are just unbelievable. It's like cause and effect. You know, you don't see this that often where you get a relationship like this. And this is mosquito methylmercury versus the input, which is wet atmospheric, rain and precipitation of mercury. And you see right here is the Arctic Alaska. This is from the stations in California, Orange County and Lake. This is here is from Midland, Michigan, and there is Florida. Boom. And it says that, and I think this is the first time that the experimental evidence had been presented that indicates that if you add more mercury, you end up with more methylmercury being produced and bioaccumulating. Or if you would have reduced it, then you would get less methylmercury bioaccumulating. The models had suggested that, and this shows it very, 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 very clearly. And we have very high precision. Those were 2003, these are the values at Tulik Lake, 2005, 2006, 2007. And when Chad moved out to Ohio and started Wayne State University, he collected a few mosquitoes, he knows how, and that fit right on the curve, excuse me. Oh, okay, I know how to go back. They told me how to do that. Okay, and that fell right on the line. It's just beautiful. And so we carried out what amounts to a literature a survey of 27 states that had bass data from their lakes, and looking at largemouth bass that between 30 and 40 centimeters, because you have to keep that, you have to keep the range the same. And the 27 states, 24 of them fell really well on the line with a confidence of above 0.7, and there are four states off of this. This is Georgia, the data we think were wrong, and New Hampshire and Maine. There's a mismatch. They're in a hotspot area, but the rain collectors are in another location. And so that probably explains that. But that's a good, so we see the relationship not only in mosquitoes, which put us on in this direction, but in bass levels. And so if the question is being asked, what can you do, then I think every contribution you can make to reducing the amount of mercury that's depositing has the potential to reduce the amount of methylmercury of fish. It's not that straightforward, but it will help. And if young people can appreciate, there's something to emphasize with the young people about the care and of disposal of mercury and mercury products. And then, why is methylmercury accumulating in the mosquitoes and the fish? And that's because it's being produced. And here we have benthically in the sediments. This is the benthic production versus the loadings. So there's a connection between the loadings and the amount of methylmercury that's being produced in the sediments. This is the relationship for the Arctic lakes. This is what we found on those three stations that we looked at on the shelf. And this is for Long Island Sound. I'll handle it. This is for Long Island Sound. And it's, again, a very good linear relationship. And it suggests that about 8% of the loadings are converted in a net way to methylmercury production in sediments. So to conclude, the net production of methylmercury in lakes in the coastal zone is about 8% of the mercury loadings, which are 65 to 75% anthropogenic. Reducing mercury inputs, that is contamination, should lead to less production of methylmercury and less bioaccumulation in fish and other biota. And we expect to see fine lower production of methylmercury in the water. And with that, let's go to sea. I was supposed to be at sea, I think. Oh, no, we were in the coastal zone. Go to sea, and I have to tell you a little bit about seawater. This is sort of fun as it gets away from talking about a contaminant. Seawater, as you recognize, is about 3.5% salt. The major ions, ones we're familiar with, sodium chloride, magnesium sulfate, Epsom salts, calcium bicarbonate, etc. And then there's another box right here, which I think will make Chris happy, because it surprised me, the next group of substances in terms of abundance, it's dissolved gases. So that means just show, once you get rid, it has a lot of salt in it, but below that, seawater is an extraordinarily dilute system, dilute medium. And this group, this other box is for nutrients that are fertilizer, nitrate and phosphate, and they're about 2 ten-thousandths of the amount that's dissolved. And then you have the trace elements. And then you have mercury. And the mercury concentration, and this is about 0.2 nanograms per kilogram. So that's 0.2 parts per trillion. And that represents about 2 × 10⁻¹⁰ of the content in seawater. Again, if we use picomoles, we end up that the average concentration for mercury in seawater is 1 picomolar. So it's really very convenient. And if you're looking at the species, dimethylmercury and monomethylmercury, they're about 10⁻¹², about a factor of 10 lower. So we have very small amounts of mercury in water. And the question is, I mean, how can such small amounts of mercury and other metals be important? And how can such small quantities be measured? I think we've shown why small quantities can be important, because in this case with mercury, it's converted to methylmercury and it bioaccumulates. And if you want to understand how that process is taking place, what kinds of reactions are occurring, then you have to be able to make those measurements at these levels. And I'm going to show you some of those determinations, which I think are the best to date. And I'm very proud of the individuals that did that. And I can say that because as I said, I didn't make the measurements. That's how good they are. And how can small quantities be measured? Well, one of the key parts of sampling, and it's actually technology that we ended up bringing to the freshwater system, is to use ultra-clean bottles suspended carefully from a special wire that has its own winch. The bottles go down through the water column below the ship. Then they're opened by a pressure release valve. You go and you sample, you close it, and you bring it back sealed, and then they're brought in to a clean laboratory to be in the water manipulated. And that's the one that's essential for obtaining samples that are free of potential contamination, which plagued oceanographers at this trace metal oceanography for many, many years. And this is a clean lab. It seems like the mercury people have a lot of fun there. And there's Caitlin Bowman analyzing the samples. We collect zooplankton very cleanly. This net is closed. It goes down below the ship. We open it and sample, and then we close it and bring it back aboard, and again, handle it very carefully, and this is a nice example of a zooplankton collection. You can be a little more cavalier when you're collecting sediments because the concentrations are higher and easier to handle. That's a box chord that you don't see very well, but that's a subsample from that, and that's mercury research at sea, and it has to be done scrupulously. And I'm going to talk about a little portion of the work that we've been doing on a continental margin. And that's mean we're going to move away from contaminated systems, such as Long Island Sound, out onto, or heavily contaminated systems, out onto the margin. And this is work I've done with Chad Hammerschmidt. And we had three major cruises, one in 2008, 2009, and in 2010. And we'll focus on the 2010. And I don't think I have to really remind you of this, but I will, that we're looking then at the production on the sediments of the continental margin in the upper slope, as well as reactions that lead to methylmercury or dimethylmercury production in the water column. And this is the 2010 cruise, and we're going to just look at this transect here, which goes from the continental shelf, which is about 76 meters out to the upper sort of lowest slope at 3,200 meters. This is a set of stations right here. And you can see, I think something like this was shown earlier, I think, by Barbara. There's the Gulf Stream. And if you move in from here, it gets cooler as you go along on the south. And there you can see somebody waving to me from our lab. This is the benthic methyl mercury flux that was determined using benthic chambers to assess the flux measurements. And again, I'm just giving the summary of this, but the values from the three cruises were greater than flux measurement, greater than 30 picomoles per meter squared per day. If you go back now, I said 20 was significant, and 30 certainly is. So now it's not just a contaminated system like Long Island Sound, but something that's less contaminated, we see, but healthy, we see significant production of methyl mercury in a continental on a continental shelf, and really the margin because we did this up on the slope. And that's likely a significant source of methyl mercury to marine biota generally, because continental margins represent about 10% of the ocean area. And so this can be quite significant if we observe fluxes like this, which we think we will, in other locations. A brief walk through in terms of oceanic productivity before I talk about the data we see in a water column. So oceanic primary production, so healthy, robust plant growth, whether it's oceanic or terrestrial, require sufficient light, abundance of macronutrients, nitrogen and phosphorus, and nanonutrients such as iron and cobalt. And these key chemicals are derived from the biological and chemical breakdown of organic substances and the weathering of minerals, and that's nature's fertilizer. And this is a generalized equation. Many of the students have gone now. A generalized equation for photosynthesis leading to the production of complex organic matter. So we have CO2, nitrate, phosphorus, water, plus a little strong acid in the presence of light, pigments, and trace metals leads complex organic matter. Fixed carbon, the lifeblood, if you will, of all of us in the oceans especially, and oxygen. So that's production. In a reverse direction then, where we have, say, net respiration or breakdown, we have oxygen burning up the organic matter, and it releases strong acid, some water, phosphorus, nitrate, and CO2. So when we have photosynthesis, CO2 is going down, the water becomes somewhat more alkaline, and oxidation leads to then the remineralization of the nutrients, increased CO2, and increased acidity. And substances that are associated with this, like trace metals, then may follow this cycle that's illustrated with the nutrients. And the production then is depends on the availability of the nutrients, and the availability of nutrients then is tied into ocean circulation. So we have places in the ocean, and Barbara showed this, we have large areas of that are oligotrophic in the ocean, not very productive, and we have other areas with that are productive. The productive areas are getting some active input of nutrients, and especially in regions like the equatorial Pacific or the west coast of continents where we have upwelling taking place. And most of the carbon, just to add to this, is really recycled in the upper portion of the ocean, and a relatively small amount reaches the bottom. And this is I want to do this because it's basic oceanography, and it's a lot of fun for me, but I hope it would be a lot of fun for you. This is a station in the Northwest Atlantic at about the latitude of the Dominican Republic. And I want to work our way through what you get from incorporation of constituents that are biologically active in the sunlight layer and then net decomposition at depth. And at this station, we're looking at temperature here, and it's around 25 degrees. I know you can't see that number, 25 degrees Celsius, and it's It goes down about 5 or 6 or 7 degrees here at 1,000 meters. And somebody said in their talk that the oceans are dark and cold. Well, you can see that below 1,000 meters, it's cold and it's dark. And most of the ocean is like that. And we know why that is. It's because that represents water that formed at high latitudes, particularly in the North Atlantic and also in the Antarctic region. And one consequence of that is that it also brings in and ventilates the ocean with oxygen. This is the salinity, and that happens to be decreasing here, but the density increases. And if you look at this plot, this is the oxygen, and it's just beautiful. This is oxygen in equilibrium with the atmosphere at the surface, and about 700-800 meters, you see this low oxygen, that's the oxygen minimum, and we can call that the region where you get maximum decomposition taking place. And then the interesting thing, if you follow it down, you notice you have more oxygen at depth than you have at the surface where photosynthesis is taking place at this particular station. And this is because, and I think Barbara mentioned this, is that this water contains much more oxygen because it's quite cold when it formed. And then we see here the increase in CO2, and I suspect Chris will be talking about this tomorrow. And then a consequence of increasing CO2 is an increase in acidity, and you can see the decrease in pH. And then there's an increase in nitrate, that's nitrate max, a phosphorus max, and we actually see a small silica max as well. And I've emphasized this because when you're looking at trace constituents, you have to see whether how well they tie in with these larger biological cycles, or biological chemical cycles, because if there are connections that you can observe and to see relationships, then it can help you very much in determining these constituents in other parts of the oceans. You can make predictions about what you might expect. And so here, then, is that transect. And this is the methylmercury, and this is what we call as a blob plot. And this is roughly 50 femtomolar methylmercury. Remember, that's 10 to the minus 15 molar. You see this, the sample on the shelf, very high, and that represents the production on that and that shelf sediments, and it appears in the water column. And we have an enhancement here on the upper slope, which is initially surprised us. We're not surprised about that anymore. And then some potential connection between that and what we see here, maybe no connection out farther. And I'm having trouble with the mouse, but if you notice that the values decline with depth, meaning that there's really not much of a contribution from the lower depths, from the sediments or hydrothermal vents. And it's blue, and I didn't go over this is the percent of dissolved oxygen. If red would be 100%, blue, deep blue, is 40%. So this is the oxygen minimum right in this region, and we see the enhancement of methylmercury in that zone. So there is a connection to the low oxygen. This is another view of this, which we just received, and Chad Hammerschmidt and Caitlin Bowman put it together. And I'm just here, what I wanted to use this for is to show the connection between production, potential production, on the upper slope, advection or diffusion to the deeper waters, and not much of a likely connection with the station farther out. So what we've seen, and we have more data than this, but I just showed you that one transect. Production and mobilization of methylmercury and dimethylmercury is occurring in sediment deposits on the upper slope. That's less than 1,000 meters. And there's same evidence then for the in situ microbial mediation of mercury methylation in the low oxygen minimum zone, the upper water column. So we're seeing two sources likely, sedimentary source and a source associated with the oxygen minimum. And I want to move to the Pacific Ocean for another look at these relationships. And this is a station that's part of the new GeoTRACES program, which is an international study of marine biogeochemical cycles and trace elements and their isotopes, and it'll probably go on for the next decade, and it's supported in the United States by the National Science Foundation. This is the station, and it's halfway between Hawaii and San Diego, and this was an intercalibration station at 30 degrees north. And thank you, Dave, for showing the conveyor belt that we, but you actually had motion. But there are two, as I mentioned earlier, just talking about the auction, there are two locations for deep water formation, major deep water formation, up in the Greenland-Norwegian Sea for the North Atlantic deep water, and it flows down the western part of the Atlantic towards the Antarctic. There's additional deep water formed in the Weddell Sea. It's the Antarctic bottom water. Then there's movement towards the Indian Ocean. You get input, but there's topography prevents it from going farther. And then we have continuation into the Pacific, and the water ending up in the Northeast Pacific, which is the oldest water in the oceans. And I think you can see this a little better in this diagram of a station between Iceland and the Antarctic, a slice, if you will, down the Atlantic Ocean. So this is north, this is south, and the green, which represents the bulk of the water mass in the Atlantic Ocean. I call this sort of a density sandwich. There's the North Atlantic deep water, readily characterized by its salinity, moving from the Norwegian Greenland Sea to the Antarctic. It is some movement upward, overriding the Antarctic bottom water, which we can see as well. That's the coldest water, the most dense. In addition, you see another water mass that forms all around the Antarctic continent, the Antarctic intermediate water. And this station track here went by the Mediterranean outflow, and you can see that as high salinity. If we go into the Pacific Ocean, we see some similarity. There's the Antarctic bottom water, the Antarctic intermediate water here. This is the Pacific deep water. And here we have an additional water mass, and it's the North Pacific intermediate water, very similar to what we have here for the Antarctic intermediate water. North Pacific and Indian water. If you look then at 30 degrees north, the station I'm going to show you will sample this this particular water mass. And here are the data. And I have to phrase this. These data, you can get really excited by all those wonderful things you see on the ocean floor and hydrothermal vents. We get very excited by the data like this. You have to be nuts, right, for us to, but we have to, it has to drive you. It's amazing. This is methylmercury in a unit of femtomolar. And I'm telling you, it says 10 to the minus 15 molar. To make measurements at that sensitivity is amazing, one. But to have oceanographically consistent results is outstanding. And that's the real test of data. You can say I can do this and I can do that, but if it doesn't fit oceanographic parameters, it's likely to be in error. So I'll follow this down, and work with me because I love this. It's filtered methylmercury, and again in those units. And I wish the mouse would work a little better, but. You see a peak right here, and you also see, and this is dimethylmercury, has a beautiful peak, and we see another peak right here at 1,000 meters. At 1,000 meters, and then if we look over here at the, because I went through that illustration with oceanographic parameters, if we now have, and we'll do the simple one, we won't look at the nutrients. We have temperature. If you can see the dashed line, I hope you can. That's the temperature. It's, I guess, around 20. It's about 25, 23 degrees here. And it decreases to 1,000 meters, as the other did. That's a thermocline. And we see the oxygen minimum here. And it's almost anoxic. This is 10 micromoles of oxygen. So it has very little oxygen in it, but it's still oxygen there, and that's the minimum. And come on, Betsy. And then there's a salinity minimum. And that's a fingerprint, if you will, of the North Pacific Intermediate water. The North Pacific Intermediate water coincides with this maxima, one in methylmercury and one for dimethylmercury. And here, the oxygen minimum, right here, coincides with the other peak. So we're seeing two sites, if you will, for the production of methylmercury and dimethylmercury in a water column. Again, we see a beautiful relationship to the oxygen minimum, and then we're seeing enhanced methylmercury and dimethylmercury associated with the North Pacific Intermediate water. And here is the North Pacific deep water here. And interestingly, these values here are very similar to what we see in the Atlantic Ocean as well. And so the two sources we see at this particular station, one is we call in the North Pacific Intermediate water, and that moves from the region off Asia between Japan and Russia, and moves across the Pacific, and in situ production associated with the oxygen minimum. This is for the methylated mercury in the North Pacific Intermediate water, and this outlines the North Pacific Intermediate water. And that's not necessary for us to try to go through any of the details, but much of it is formed in the Sea of Okhotsk, which is a fairly large sea between the northern part of Japan and Russia. And the transit time to get to the intercalibration station of this water is about 20 to 70 years. And we think that's too long for methylmercury and dimethylmercury to be stable in the water column under those conditions. So it's more likely that it's forming as a consequence, on its way, as a consequence of atmospheric deposition to the oceans. And you know, just to broaden this a little bit, with respect to the oxygen minimum zone, this is what we just looked at, the coincidence between the maxima and the oxygen minimum zone. And for the Northwest Atlantic, this is the data, I really didn't show you that in detail, from our work. And this is a plot from the Northeast Atlantic. And we're seeing much more than this now. There's a strong coincidence between enhancements in methylmercury and dimethylmercury associated with the oxygen minimum. And this is about 1,000 meters. And the upper 1,000 meters are clearly influenced by anthropogenic mercury from atmospheric deposition. So the summary is methylmercury, dimethylmercury appear to be produced in oxygenated and low oxygen regions of the marine water column. Deep sea sediments and hydrothermal vents are not a significant source of methylmercury to the ocean. This had been suggested, that mercury substrates in the methylated species have an anthropogenic origin. That's less than 1,000 meters. And this is a budget that we put together, a working budget for methylmercury. Firstly, about 70% of the mercury inputs are anthropogenic. And just like we had Long Island Sound, the blue represents sources and the red represents sinks. Now, I'm not going to go through this. I guess you're really happy about that because it's not necessary. But we can look at it in a different way. What are the potential sources of methylmercury? Atmospheric deposition of methylmercury is not important. Atmospheric deposition of inorganic mercury is, and that provides the reactant for the production of methylmercury. Deep sea sediments and hydrothermal vents are not important. And rivers are important locally. You know, for example, Long Island Sound, that's an important contribution. There are many other situations like that. Production in the sediments on the continental margin is likely to be very important, and especially as the experimental work expands and other margins are looked at. And then intermediate water production, particularly the oxygen minimum zone, is important, it's important, but in sort of select areas. I think this is likely very important along in the equatorial Pacific, where you have significant upwelling, and upwelling of low oxygen water will be containing methyl and dimethylmercury. And I'm not going to summarize, I'm going to leave this as my concluding slide. And not all of us, but I'm still going at it, pursuing mercury in the environment. And I want to acknowledge a number of people, and also the Rydell Fund. I'm the Rydell visiting professor this fall, and I really greatly appreciate that. And I just love the atmosphere at Gustavus. It's just been stimulating. I almost feel like I'm back as an undergraduate. And again, the wonderful atmosphere and support of the Gustavus staff and faculty and Nobel Conference Committee are most appreciated. And what I showed you here, most of this work's been done by everyone else, but many thanks for the assistance go to Jeff Jeremiahson at the college, Kyle Longboard at Woods Hole, Chad Hammerschmidt and Caitlin Bowman at Wright State University, Rob Mason and Prentice Balcom in our department, and Dan Engstrom, unfortunately, was sick. He was willing to be here tonight from the St. Croix Watershed Research Station. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Fitzgerald, for that wonderfully illuminating talk. I'll ask our panel to come up and join us one more time today. I know it's been a long day, but we'll have a quick question and answer period this evening. So submit your questions either on slips of paper or by the internet, and we'll get them to our speaker. Thanks.
Let's start the question and answer with questions from the panel for Bill, if you have any.
Yes, thank you so much. It was very interesting, and I'm very interested in the social responsibilities as a scientist. If you know that mercury poisoning is very damaging to young people, and if you have found evidence that much of this mercury, methylmercury, comes from coal-fired plants, is that the end of your responsibility to society, or do you feel you need to take an extra step and actually take a public stand on, say, coal-fired burning?
Well, I think that's. Let me step back just a moment. The many mercury scientists have taken that type of stand. There's no question about that, and it's a challenge. And as it's once you start that type of activity, I'm not saying that quite right. Because I have personal experience, and it hurts, because there is a lot of money, lawyers, et cetera, that you have to deal with, and it takes an enormous amount of time. And I was going to mention Pat Patterson, who determined the age of the Earth, and he's one of my mentors, and that's the 4.5 billion years. He determined that, but while he was doing it, he discovered that the entire ocean was contaminated with lead. Mm. And so he stopped. That's what he had determined the age of the Earth you would have a Nobel Prize if there were a Nobel Prize in geology. He went through agony. He was at Caltech. There was an effort to have him fired from the faculty. He lost funding, and it took him a while to recover from that experience. And why am I illustrating that? Because once you do this, you have to recognize you're going to have to devote a good portion of your effort and time to trying to prevent that. I think it's, in some ways it might be better to try to do that politically. Anyways, mercury scientists in general, I'm not doing this very well, but I have quite proactive, really quite proactive in approaching the government fighting for a mercury rule, which is just introduced, and that is going to lower emissions from, at least in the United States, from coal-fired power plants. And that's much of that has come from the efforts of mercury scientists, both by the work that they did and their proactivity with respect to confronting the power companies, et cetera.
I have a question. With just one station in the Eastern Pacific at 30 North, how do you separate mercury formation that's potentially happening at the OMZ through biogeochemical processes from the intermediate water bringing contaminated water from Japan? I mean, how do you separate with one station where that mercury is formed? Methyl mercury.
I think I understand the question. Is the one station, how representative that is of all the potential sources?
Yeah, I mean, I've told you that we've just discovered, and others, that tuna carry over mercury from Japan, and they come in 3 weeks. So how do you know when you make one station measurement at that site and look at the biogeochemical processes at the OMZ there that what you're measuring as methyl mercury hasn't been transported from the OMZ?
Oh, yeah, well, that's what I was that possibility was suggested for the North Pacific Intermediate Water. Oh, no, we would love to, scientifically, to explore that. There's effectively been very, very few studies in the Pacific Ocean of mercury and mercury distributions. It's taking a while to get enough. We're getting more and more individuals involved. But we can suggest, but it's certainly, it's more for proposal, really. You know, National Science Foundation could argue that this we would like to look at a transect or a broad transect from either from the eastern part of the Pacific to the west or vice versa. We'd love to do that.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. Can I ask one question? I was curious about this correlation between the oxygen minimum zone and the methylmercury concentrations, and there's been a suggestion with climate change, global warming, warming of the oceans, that the oxygen minimum zones will expand greatly in the future. What might you infer about the changes of methylmercury?
I suspect there'll be an increase in methylmercury. And in fact, what you see there, you see methylmercury is being presumably produced all the way through the water column. And this is one hypothesis. And the reason you see these nice enhancements in the oxygen minimum zone is because the demethylation reaction is not very efficient in low oxygen. We don't know that for sure, but that's a suggestion. But I think it's highly likely expanding low oxygen regions will lead to enhancement in the production of, or stabilization of methylmercury.
Hmm. Wait, did you have one of?
So you mentioned that mercury was the prima donna of the periodic table ballet. Are there any support dancers? You know, what other molecules come close to having the same sorts of bioaccumulation? I'm thinking of cadmium and these other compounds.
Could you repeat that again?
Yeah, well, I'm just saying, so mercury is one of many in that periodic table. I mean, what are the other compounds which have the same sorts of bioaccumulation properties? Is it part of the...
Well, some, for example, lead doesn't really bioaccumulate up in the bone. And the methylmercury is particularly pernicious because it loves sulfur. Mm. And sulfur, of course, is part of proteins. Mm. And so it ends up complexing in the muscle. And I think there are very few other that I can think of that are bioconcentrated in any way like that.
Okay, we have a question from the audience, actually a couple along the same theme. With switching to compact fluorescent bulbs that might have more mercury in them, is this something that we should be concerned about with respect to the ocean?
Don't break them.
Don't break them.
Yeah. And I noticed that Minnesota is so proactive. You just pay attention to what Minnesota is suggesting. I mean, they have any number of places where you can dispose properly, or they'll take your compact fluorescent bulbs. You know.
Okay. I think we have one from our online audience too. There were several concerns about being bitten by mercury-contaminated mosquitoes here. But I think on a serious note, are there concerns about that mosquito mercury being a significant reservoir?
I doubt that. Yeah, I don't think so. Okay. No, don't worry about that.
All right, so it's just unpleasant, not unsafe.
Yeah.
Yeah. We have some more coming in.
Quick question about biogeochemical processes. At the OMZ, is it possible that in that layer in the Eastern Pacific, we have more microbial presence there because of the carbon issue of what's raining down there, and that there's some link here that where you have more microbes, you're getting more production?
That could be, but I don't know that. I really can't answer that question.
Yeah, I think the question that was just delivered here is kind of along those lines, is what exactly is going on in the oxygen minimum zone to produce that methylmercury? Is it the confluence of more bacteria, more sulfur, in the same place?
Yeah, I'll give one potential scenario. It's easy to methylate mercury. That's the first. If you just had inorganic mercury in the presence of sodium acetate, you can end up with some methylmercury. And so there are any number of organic substances that are being either consumed or released in the oxygen minimum zone. And so that may provide the molecules that have the potential for methylating mercury. And it may be that cobalamin, which is vitamin B12, that also can donate a methyl group and methylate. And that's thought that there may be some enhancement in cobalamin in there. But we don't know. That's a mystery. That has to be explored.
Yeah. So you notice that the biologists always want to take credit for the chemistry that goes on in the ocean.
I see this.
He's looking for where is that biological connection. We always say that chemistry would be much more simple in the ocean if there were no biologies.
Yes. Hey, remember, that's the White Shark Cafe. I'm sure they're doing something there.
I think we have time. I'm getting away from the wings. We have time for one more question, and this comes from the audience here. Do you think that we need to plan for a long-term solution for mercury pollution in the oceans, or is this something that if we simply decrease the input to the ocean, it will work itself out over a short time scale? So what are we
A very good question, and it has a good part and a not-so-good part. The open ocean, we see the influence of reduced input from the atmosphere that would lead to less methylmercury production. In the near shore, which has a lot of what we call legacy mercury from past contamination, if you look at that core when it was 12 times, unfortunately, even if we had no mercury going into the system, we would continue to methylate. And it'll take decades to maybe more than a century for certain coastal areas to recover. Whereas the open ocean and the water column recover relatively fast.
Okay, so there's sort of a short-term pool of mercury, and then there's this longer-term recycling, like we have with so many other elements. All right, are there any more questions from the panel?
It's been a long day.
All right, it has been a long day. So thank you all for staying with us. I've been asked to make one brief announcement, and that is that the room down here will be cleaned and reset tonight, so you have to take all of your belongings with you, even if you're coming back in the morning. So please remember to do that. I'm sure that they'll put them somewhere safe if you accidentally leave something. But we'll see you tomorrow.